Hello, I'm Mr. Tisdale. How are you?
Doing great, Mr.
How are you?
Hello.
Hello.
How are y'all?
Good.
And you're on camera, so.
Okay, so, you ready to go back?
Yeah, are either any of the gentlemen here yet?
I've seen some come in, so you.
Okay, I know I've got one more coming. He's called. He was detained in a court proceeding.
Okay.
So he will be here in a little bit. So, yeah.
Door.
Say it.
Open?
Yes, please.
Okay, all right, you want to come on around?
Thank you.
Thanks, Carla. All right, you're welcome.
Put on my chair, actually.
Yeah, yeah, hurts.
Yeah.
Hey. I don't know where to go.
Oh, right around here, around the corner. Pardon the commissioners do their work session.
Thank you.
The other day it was my therapy, and she said there was absolutely no traffic. She said I drove straight back.
Well, I've actually got one. We're waiting on Mr. Leach, who's the other panel member. He was detained in court. Okay,
I
yes.
I got one for him. I just crossed my name off and put it on the clock.
Okay, thank you. We'll be sitting at this end.
I'm Chuck Pollack.
Hi, Mr. Captain. Pollack. Nice to meet you.
Good to meet you.
So I have name tags for all of you. Okay. You're the alternate.
Oh, yeah?
Okay.
We'll work and see. That's fine.
That may work out just fine. Then we're waiting on Mr. Pierce also. The options are to begin the meeting, or then we would have to review when Mr. Leach arrives. So probably the best option would be to wait until he does arrive to begin the meeting. And we'll try to proceed as soon as possible. Okay. I'm going to be right back. All right, Kim.
She had 6 hours of ethics yesterday.
She gets some stress. That's what worries.
kid, you need to put pressure on another kid, you need to take pressure off. Did you go into private practice right out of law school?
Yeah, I did for a year. Went to the DA's office, was it on the just for trial cases.
In Hall or?
Hall, it was not light and then just another 2 or 3 years. Started on the bed.
She thinks that she wants to, you know, she's idealistic now. She thinks she wants to do prosecution.
How are you?
Well, thank you.
Months in and still doing that. We're having a third drug summit on Tuesday night. We've got it's, I'm proud of being a part of that. That's one I'm really happy at. It's sad, each one that you go to, when, I mean, because I've sort of taken up the people are asking me for answers, you know, but so many grandparents raising children. You know, what do I do? I've had one that, you know, I had a lady last time. Her son died of alcoholism, and she's got a grandchild on drugs, and, you know, people don't know where to turn.
No, they sure don't.
And it wrecks the whole. Destroys the whole, and it's rampant. There are people, kids dying all the time.
Agenda for you.
Okay.
And I usually, I don't depend on you.
The day of the
agenda is in the home.
Said it is, we thought that we can scare people into not using it. And we really have been one of those. We're just now getting on about how the brain works. And then how the issue before. It's lots of times it's
She will set up a little mic thing. And all you have to do is set up a little red button. And I'm gonna move it down here when we start. Because I noticed last week it didn't pick up, so it picked up okay.
The people with OD started using 12 and 13 years of age. And 65% of started using the government if they're 12 or 13, you know, that young age. So every year you can put off beyond it. Because you teach a grade, the only way to build pressure is through the means of marijuana.
Mr. Pollack, did you need a copy of that?
No, I think I have that.
That's a consolidated copy there, so.
They say Colorado gets so much marijuana.
I haven't heard from Mr. Pierce to see where he is.
University of Georgia, he's over at pharmaceutical school. And he was our speaker when the judges invited me to come to neuroscience and drug awareness. He was an addict himself and had been clean 37 years. And he had a judge that gave him a shot that believed him. He'd have never been to Georgia being able to do that. Nydia, are you coming to the drug summit?
I wasn't aware of it, other than what I just kind of heard you talking about. So, it's at when you're talking about?
Tuesday at 6:30.
Is there another, isn't there a work session? Or is there a planning commission meeting, a work session meeting?
I hope not.
Okay, because that might be. I'm not sure.
Nothing I have to be at, I don't think.
Next week is the regular meeting, right?
The what?
Next week's the regular meeting on Thursday, right?
Yes, Thursday.
Yeah, Thursday, not Tuesday.
Okay.
So, I don't know, because work session, regular work session.
Yeah, I still have to check the calendar.
That one time it was off, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, why was that? The calendar was a little skewed.
Maybe holidays, it was Memorial Day or something.
Okay.
When it was set, like at the first of the year.
I was thinking maybe snow days or something.
I think if it's like a week where there's 5 weeks, there's a week where there's not a meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Or a month where
and I think we did change in setting the calendar because of a holiday or something.
Because I just know what, it wasn't too long ago, I thought, oh, I'm going to get through the work set or the regular meeting at 5, and then I looked at my phone and I was like, oh, what's all I need today?
When does Jennifer come back?
She's not.
Oh, she's not. Her baby's precious.
Yeah.
I see the pictures on Facebook.
Yeah, she's really cute. Apparently she sleeps all day though.
I wouldn't stay up all night.
Yeah.
It happens.
It's not good. Yeah, she's cute. And her little boy's just precious.
Mm-hmm.
His curly hair.
What about Alyssa?
Alyssa went to work for Delta Dental.
Does she like it?
So, yeah. I think she actually misses some of the newspaper.
Okay.
She makes a lot of money. Can't wait for that.
So that's two now that are gone.
Mm-hmm.
Are you hiring or what are you doing to fill in
the gap? They're hiring, yeah. They're hiring. But that's not what she's doing.
Crystal, did you go to the civil service board meeting this morning?
Pierce is on his way.
I missed it too.
I didn't make it to that one, no. Oh, she was just asking about the civil service board yesterday. I didn't make it to that one. I can't get over there.
Mr. Pierce is also on his way, so.
Are y'all getting any new things in Dawson? Is that where Target is going?
Yeah, in that area. Target's still like the album. Yes, I'm sure they told somebody about it. They got the numbers.
Yes.
Right here.
Mr. Leach and Mr. Pierce.
Them right there.
Mr. Pollack.
I call you, Mr. Leach?
He's come down.
Mr. Pollack.
You're Mr. Pollack.
Mr. Hayden.
Oh.
It was approved back in the mid-2000s. And you think, well, it's just there in Dawson, not with that.
Pierce, yeah.
That's a great line of traffic, not here.
No, he's not here. This is Mr. Homans.
Oh, that's what you're most right.
This is Kathy. He just walked in. He just walked in the door. Thanks, okay. All right, thanks, Mike. He's on his way.
Because I was just judging it based upon the emails that he had sent earlier.
Hey, how are you?
Nice to see you.
Hey, how are you doing?
Good, I'm Chuck Paul.
Chuck, Sam Pierce, nice to see you.
Sorry to keep everybody waiting.
Hi, Mr. Leach. Hey, I'm Kathy.
Hey, good to see you. Where do you want?
All right, the three of y'all, right here, and Mr. Pollack, if you want to move down and sit there, he's the alternate for today.
Mark Leach.
Hey, Mike, go ahead.
Hey, good to see you.
I have a little, so that you can all know who each other is.
Oh, all right, Chuck Pollack.
Yes, sir. How are you?
Good to see you.
Hey.
All right, Sam Pierce.
Nice
hey.
To see you.
Good to see you. You got the honorary chair.
I will let you take it. So they let you loose a little bit faster than you thought in federal court?
He told me I could leave, but I couldn't leave because I had a client there.
Yes.
Thank you. I was just lucky he had something he needed to do.
All right, Mr. Pierce, are you going to sit there? I mean, that's fine if you do. We'll just move your badge down.
All right.
Or your name tag. Okay. All right. Well, good afternoon. I'm Kathy Echols, clerk to the Forsyth County Ethics Panel. It is August the 14th, and I call this meeting to order at 2:19 p.m. Those in attendance are panelist members Mr. Arthur Leach, Mr. Michael O'Hagan, Mr. Samuel Pierce Jr., and our alternate panel member, Mr. Charles Pollack. Again, Clerk Kathy Echols, Assistant Clerk Kim Reilly, Commissioner Cindy Mills, Mr. Joey Homans, Attorney for Commissioner Mills, and the members of the public. The first item on the agenda is a selection. The first item on the agenda is the adoption of the agenda. Do I have a motion to adopt?
I move that it be adopted.
A second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
The next item on the agenda is a selection of a chairman. Is there a motion?
Move that Art be nominated.
Good. Sorry,
second.
Okay, second.
Come in later.
Object.
So, Mr. Leach, okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Mr. Leach. Before I do turn the meeting over to you, Mr. Chairman, I do need to make two announcements. There was a request for a postponement of the investigatory review, which would have moved the meeting past the 60-day meeting requirement according to the ethics ordinance. Therefore, I believe that it was appropriate that the meeting proceed as scheduled and within the 60-day window. Mr. Rorke, the complainant in this case, wanted to also advise the panel that he did want to be here, but due to his work schedule, he could not attend the meeting. And also, Mr. Homans, who's the attorney for Commissioner Mills, has informed me that he has a Dawson County Commission meeting that was previously scheduled at 4 o'clock p.m. in Dawson County. Therefore, he will be leaving about 3:30 from this meeting also. So now I turn the meeting over to you, Mr. Leach.
Okay, well, I am not altogether that familiar with how these things proceed. So, Kathy, can you give us an overview of what we should be doing today according to the rules?
According to the rules, you are to be determining from the complaint that was presented with the evidence, and then the response from the respondent as to whether or not an ethics violation has been committed, and whether or not it should proceed to an ethics hearing, a hearing before this ethics panel.
Well, even though Mr. Rorke is not here, is there anyone that came on his behalf or who was going to be a witness to anything?
Did you nominate? No, sir.
So we will have nothing but the petition in order to make this determination today.
Right.
And if we decide that it should go on to a full hearing, we'll set a date for that. And is there a restriction on the time for that?
According to the ethics ordinance, I have not, there is not a date, time limit for that to be set.
There's only a time limit for this hearing?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, since Mr. Rourke's not here, maybe we should hear from Ms. Mills. Is that agreeable?
Well,
can we do that?
I mean, in an investigatory review, the complainant nor the respondent have the option to speak unless it does not, the ordinance is not clear if you want to ask them questions. I could say that that was up to the panel.
Okay. Well, when, you're Ms. Mills?
No.
Okay.
There's Commissioner Mills.
Okay. When you filed your answer, I went through it at that time. I think it would be helpful to me, I don't know how the other panelists feel, for counsel to give us an overview of your position. I mean, I think that would help me. Do you agree, gentlemen?
Yes, sir.
Why
don't you go ahead and do that?
Yes, sir. We have to. I appreciate the opportunity. Again, I'm Joey Homans. We've tried to set forth in the answer response to the specific allegations as we understand those specific allegations. But as to Castleberry Road, the complaint alleges violations as they relate to actions taken on February the 20th, 2014. Castleberry Road had been the subject of and been approved by the voters on 3 SPLOS prior to the vote on February 7, 2014. Monies had been spent to widen the right-of-way and proceed with the project. Approximately $9 million had been spent on the project. There had been some delay as to some study, whatever it was. There had been some delay in proceeding, and all the commissioners voted on the 14th was to set aside what had been done in November of 2012 so that they could proceed on with what the voters had approved, which is what the law requires. The allegations are that Ms. Mills voted on these topics on February 17th, 2014, the four motions, despite the fact that there was a sign beside a portion of Castleberry Road in the city of Cumming that had already been widened pursuant to the previous approvals for Castleberry Road. And somehow the fact that that sign was there presented her with a conflict of interest. So we have submitted the affidavit of Mr. Bryant, who's the owner of the real estate company where she works. She's an independent contractor. She receives no financial benefit from any sale unless she's involved with it, and she was not. In fact, the listing on that property had expired some 4 years before this vote was even taken. And Mr. Bryan was allowed to leave the sign there by the owners, so he left the sign there for his own advertising. But she had nothing to do with the listing, had nothing to do with that property.
Let me stop you for just a second.
Yes,
sir. I may have misunderstood, but I thought you said a vote on February the 17th.
Yes.
I thought it was on February the 20th. Was there a different...
I'm sorry, you're right. It's February the 20th.
Okay, I just wanted to make February sure there was not a meeting.
No.
Which I was unaware.
I'm sorry, I read a wrong date.
That's fine.
February the 20th of 2014, based upon that all they did was undo a stop on some section of the road that had been approved on November the 15th of 2012, and we've given you all those minutes. But all I'm trying to point out is that there's a series of reasons as to why there's not a sufficient basis to go forward with this complaint. Those are that the Castleberry Road widening was decided long before, 10 years or so before February the 20th of 2014. It had not only been decided by the commissioners, it had been placed on road project lists on three SPLOS, and the voters approved
that.
That
had been rescinded, hadn't it?
Well, only a rescission was on a portion of Castleberry Road that's not this portion of Castleberry Road where the sign was. There was a study that was done, and there was a challenge to that study, and one of the commissioners in November had said, let's stop proceeding based upon that study. But then nothing more was done. And as y'all are aware, once the voters approve a SPLOS, the commissioner's discretion is largely limited. My point is that had nothing to do, as Mr. Bryan sets forth in his affidavit, the portion of the road where this sign was located had already been widened. That was completed. So it was another portion of Castleberry Road entirely. That's one issue we have, is that there was no conflict of interest for Ms. Mills based upon Castleberry Road because of what had happened before she was ever a commissioner. The second issue is that she had nothing to do with the specific allegations of this complaint, the property being listed by Bryan Properties. She had no financial interest.
Why is that property sold at any time since February the 20th?
No, it's not even been listed. He just had the sign there, the listing expired, and their longtime clients basically said, can I just leave the sign? They said, sure. And in fact, the sign, as a result of this, Mr. Bryan removed the sign. But
did Bryan Properties sell any of the properties involved in the Castleberry improvement?
I'm not going to say any. Nothing anywhere near, nothing in the vicinity of this property. I mean, they're
none of the property that Forsyth County would have taken as part of the improvement? They would have had no role in that?
I mean, you're going back, if you're saying none of any of the improvements, you're going to go back 12 years. So I don't know that even Commissioner Mills would know that because she didn't work with him back then.
Well, all right, let's go from the time that she worked with him then. Pick up at the time that, because clearly if she wasn't, she's not employed by, but she's related to, and she's, I suppose, a 1099
yes.
Relationship with the company. Certainly, we can't hold her responsible what happens before she comes right into that relationship. So pick it up from that point and come forward.
Have you been involved in any property on Castleberry Road?
No.
No.
I don't even think I've ever had a listing on Castleberry Road.
And to your knowledge, did Bryan Properties even have any?
To my knowledge, none.
Okay.
But I'm telling you, they're a good-sized company, so if we go back 12 years on Castleberry Road, there may be one. But as to Mr. Rourke's complaint on this specific piece of property, any road widening had been accomplished long before February 20, 2014.
So this is an eminent domain taking, correct? This is a taking by eminent domain?
This one wasn't. There was nothing taken. It had already been acquired.
But what you're saying is there would have been properties taken pursuant to eminent domain.
I have no indication there was ever eminent domain. Whether they negotiated it with the property owner, I have no knowledge of any of that. Don't represent Brian Properties.
Okay.
Don't represent the landowner.
I mean, it looks to me like the crux of what is alleged here is that there's this property sign that is up, and he sees it, I guess, in a YouTube video. And then several days later, the sign is down. What happened that caused the sign to come down? I mean, did Brian Properties receive a citizen complaint relating to that sign, or did the word get back? Ms. Mills, that there was some problem with the sign being there. I mean, what's going on here? And the only reason why I ask that is I do think that Mr. Rorke has a right to understand the sequence of events and why things happened the way they did.
And let me just say, we would have preferred that he would have asked that question rather than filing this ethics complaint. And again, I don't represent Mr. Brian. I don't represent Brian Properties. But it was my understanding that once whatever this YouTube video, whatever information went out, Mr. Brian realized that was creating some source of controversy, so he took it down. But that's just my understanding.
I'll be happy to answer, because the people that did the video that put it up, when I reached out to them and told them that that wasn't my listing, that I had nothing to do with it. I didn't even know that there was a sign in the city. It wasn't in, where the sign was located was already widened. It was nothing to even do with the county and the vote that we were taking. But when I reached out to them and told them, they removed it. They removed that part of the video. And then I reached out to my broker and I said, do you have a listing? It's being put as that I've got a conflict. I didn't even know he had the sign, because I just hadn't noticed it's been up there so long. I guess I don't go that way much. But anyway, he said, that listing expired long ago. I'll take it down if it's a problem. And I said, well, it's already been created into being a problem. And he said, well, I don't even have the listing. I just left the sign up. So he went and removed it.
So you're in this situation where you're a commissioner, but you're also a business person within the
right.
county. And when you put up signs in other places in the county, has that ever caused the problem prior to this one?
No, not yet. I mean, if I were to have a zoning, or say if I were to have a piece of property that I'm listed and I have it for sale and it gets brought to the commission for a vote, I would of course have to recuse myself and disclose that. Okay. I've not had that conflict come up yet. If I do, I will. But this, I did not view this at all as being a conflict, because I didn't, number one, didn't even know that he had a sign in the city. It wasn't on the section of the road that was widening to begin with. We weren't voting on something taking place in the city. What we were voting on was to complete an action that the voters had approved back long ago. It was a very controversial vote, and there have been, people have put things out on the blogs encouraging people to bring ethics violations as a punishment for that vote.
I guess maybe my question is this. How could it somehow benefit a real estate agent to list property that was about to be smaller? Wouldn't you lose part of a commission or the value of the road if it was
If it were to be taken. I don't think that was their allegation.
Okay.
I think their allegation was that if I voted to widen it, I was improving the value of the property. Maybe that would have been the case had it been on the part of the road. That property was already widened. It was okay. Already a four lane or whatever.
I guess that was my problem, was I didn't understand his position as to how it would somehow financially benefit you to now have less property that could, maybe he thought the widening would improve the value, I don't know.
Is this a corner parcel?
In the city, yes.
So one side of it has been four lane, but coming down the castle there, it had not been widened on that part. Correct?
All of Castleberry is widened in the city. Not the other corner of that particular parcel
is Hutchinson, which has nothing to do with what this hearing's about.
Did Mr. Rorke ever reach out to you?
No.
Or your counsel?
No.
No.
Has he ever attended a council meeting where this issue was brought up and you were there?
I've seen him at some meetings, but I don't know that this particular issue, to be honest, it was never an issue.
Was it ever something that he attempted to bring up and put on the agenda for the council to consider or discuss in a...
He might have got up and talked about it during public comment before. We're not allowed to speak and address at public comment. I don't know that, I can't attest that yes he did or no he didn't, but he could have. He's gotten up and spoke against other commissioners and different things, so I want to be careful and not say that he didn't.
Let me ask you this way. As a commissioner, I would imagine you have an email address that is a public commissioner email address. Has he ever emailed you on any topic whatsoever?
He has sent emails complaining about zonings before, or you know, talking about why you shouldn't approve this or approve that.
Did he email you specifically with regard to this?
No, not that I can.
What he calls a $12 million vote? Was it a $12 million
vote? Well, that's the reason I keep emphasizing this was a series of SPLOS and that's why we put them in our response, because you'll see when the SPLOS were approved, there would be dollar amounts assigned to different versions. So we take issue with the $12 million vote in the February meeting as well, but I'm not going to tell you that the total widening over 10 or 12 years may not have added up to $12 million. And let me say, too, that at the February 20 meeting, there was no mention by Mr. Rorke when it was on the agenda. There was no mention from him. You'll see that in the minutes, that he did not address any issue in the meeting about Commissioner Mills.
Was he in attendance?
But there was a lot of people, I don't know.
They publish their agendas as they're required to by law, and they have the opportunity, citizens have the opportunity to address items on the agenda.
And we get thousands of emails. I mean, literally, you know, I couldn't even guess how many. But I do remember, now that you say that, I called Mr. Rorke about Castleberry Road. Now that you say that, I had forgotten. I instigated and called him myself to discuss how Castleberry Road had evolved and when the vote was first taken, when it was on SPLOS 5 and what it said and the amount of money that was being spent and whatnot. We had a very civil, nice conversation, and he never brought up anything about my sign or being worried about it at the time I called him on the phone.
Well, what is the relationship to that call and this petition?
I don't think anything, but...
But I mean, in other words,
why did you call him?
Because I tried to reach out to, I reach out to people that send me emails and try to explain where the vote's coming from. And I do remember I called Bob Rorke and talked to him. I've met him during my campaign, and I was trying to explain my position on the vote.
I think what he was asking, was that in after the complaint was
filed? Oh, way before.
Ms. Echols filed his complaint on June 19, 2014. Can you give us an idea, time-wise?
When I called him?
Yeah, when you
it called would him. Probably, it was before the vote, or right around the vote in February.
February.
Didn't you say that was February 20th when
February
we took the vote?
February 20th was when the vote was taken. The 17th was when the sign came.
Okay.
Now, just flipping through your response, do we have an affidavit from Ms. Mills?
No, she just verified her answer.
Verified the answer,
yes.
Right. So that's essentially an affidavit,
yes.
Just everything that's presented.
Okay.
Yeah,
the only affidavit we got.
Right.
And unless I overlooked it, there's no copy of the expired listing in here, was there?
No, he looked for that, but it was 4 years ago. I'm sure he could have, if we'd have told him, I've got to have it.
Right.
we go forward with an evidentiary hearing, we'll look again.
Okay.
Brian has not picked up the relisting of that property since February 20th.
Not to my knowledge.
Well, there's no signs of it.
No signs.
To the best of your knowledge, is anybody listing the property at this point?
Not to my knowledge. And the property's not in the area where the property is already wide. That property in question that's in the complaint is not in the county, it's not in the part that we voted on to widen.
Okay, Ms. Echols, I have a question. Once the petition's filed, a response is received by your office, does Mr. Rorke have the right at that point to reply in any sense?
That is a question I've posed to our county attorney, because once the complainant files the complaint, it's forwarded, and then the response from the respondent, there is no provision in the county ordinance for for a rebuttal or an answer from the complainant.
Yeah, I think we call it a reply.
A reply, okay.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. Did Mr. Rourke request the opportunity to reply to what had been provided?
Yes, yes.
And did he give you some sort of communication in that regard?
He, as I stated on that email, there we go. He had stated given his work schedule, would they consider postponing the hearing regarding this complaint? And because he had been on vacation, apparently we're out of pocket. In consulting with the county attorney, because of the deadlines of required by the ethics ordinance to meet within 60 days of the complaint being filed, it was decided to go ahead and proceed with the investigatory review. He did want to be here, but due to his schedule, he could not be here.
But what you communicated with him, that it was not going to be postponed.
Yes, sir.
And in response to that, did he say, "Can I send in some type of written rebuttal, reply, whatever label you want to put on?"
I did not print out that email. He did say that he would, I should have printed that email out.
Just what you recall is fine with us.
He said he would not be able to present a rebuttal since it had to go and be held now. Yes, sir.
All right. Do we have the option of providing him the opportunity before we make the decision on this investigative step to get a rebuttal from him? Because if I had to vote this afternoon, I would not be voting to advance this. But at the same time, I think he should have an opportunity to submit something to us, just in the event he has some issue with what is before us.
There again,
is it our prerogative?
I don't know.
I think you said the ordinance doesn't provide for it.
Right. The ordinance just states that the once a complaint is filed.
What paragraph?
I wish it was numbered by pages, but it is section 14 under complaints. Okay. And it's on number one on like that second, or I'm sorry, number 2 and 3.
Okay. Let me just take a look.
Okay.
Okay. I want to ask a question, this, please understand, it is not a critical or any question in the least bit. But were there efforts made to schedule this 2 or 3 weeks ago so that there might have been a fallback period where it'd still be within the 60 days if somebody had a question?
Let's see. I remember it was about 2 weeks ago that we were able to coordinate the schedules. So he was given, let's see.
Let me handle it this way, Mr. Holmes. Would you object to us providing him a reasonable period of time to submit something to us in response to what you have provided, keeping this open? And, you know, not speaking for the other people that are on the panel, but based on the evidence that I see right now, the case as it stands right now would not be sustained. In other words, you would basically be victorious. But I do think that under these circumstances, a citizen has a right to be heard. And I worry, just because his work schedule conflicted, that he ought to have an opportunity to at least react. And he may not have felt that he had that opportunity or that right to do that. But I'd like to extend him that opportunity. And I'm asking whether you and Ms. Mills would object to that procedure.
I will tell you no, unless he raises new issues in any rebuttal or reply. And that's my concern.
Well, my perspective would be any new issues would be a new complaint.
Right.
So we'll, if you will,
it would have to address if he has any kind of documents, evidence, affidavits that contradict what had been submitted by the respondent.
That's exactly what I'm talking about.
I agree. I mean, just narrow, just in reply to what's already been presented.
Right. And that's all I'm concerned with, is I don't want to make it open-ended. Where
let's say, because I think it's very important, especially when one of his complaints is, and this is a typical complaint, but at least from the public's perspective, they need to believe everything is transparent out in the open. And he obviously does not believe that's what occurred at this vote on the 20th. So I agree with you, Art, if there's some methodology to afford him the opportunity, then it's up to him whether he avails himself of it or not.
And as long as I'm not precluded from filing a motion to strike what is new and different allegations, if it's focused on what he has here, I understand.
You'll find we'll do that on our own initiation.
Right.
We'll do it on our own. You won't even have to file that motion. All right. So with no objection, the motion that I'm placing on the table is that we allow Mr. Rorke 10 business days, which is essentially 2 weeks, but 10 business days so that he can count it out, in order to get a response filed with Ms. Echols. So that's my motion. Is it seconded?
Seconded.
And all those agreeing, say aye.
Aye.
And just so there is not any sort of an amendment to it, any question on his part as to when, in his notification, let's put whatever the due date is, which then would be actually two weeks from tomorrow.
Yes.
Tomorrow is the 15th, so the 29th.
Do not count today. And then if we do not hear from him, I suppose we have to reconvene and officially make a determination. We'll do it at that time.
Okay. But while we have it, should we go ahead and decide how much time would you want to respond to anything which he files?
Just to tell y'all, the 29th is going to be Labor Day weekend.
Right.
So if y'all just give me 7, normally I'd ask for 5. If you'll give me 7, I will have whatever reply.
That's fine. So can we consider the motion amended?
Yes.
To provide that the respondent has 7 days to reply to anything that Mr. Rorke files.
Yes, sir. Do you agree, Mr. Hagan?
I do. Agree.
We all agree.
Can I ask a question just for clarification?
Sure.
Because I've never been through this process before, and I'm trying to understand it myself. So in our ethics ordinance, people have the opportunity to bring their complaint and then to bring a rebuttal to that complaint. Mr. Rorke brought his
evidence in his complaint. And then we had a chance to rebut or to answer that complaint. And now we are extending him the opportunity to add more to that complaint or to expand, just to expound.
Just if he's got something that contradicts something that you submitted as part of your response.
So it's a rebuttal to my rebuttal.
That's a good way.
Right,
sure rebuttal, yeah. Okay, we'll call it that.
If he had.
And then we have a chance to rebut the rebut the rebut.
Rebut or comment upon.
Okay.
But as I look at the ordinance, I don't see that this process is precluded by it. And but I do believe that the whole purpose is to try to give citizens an opportunity to be heard. And with his work schedule conflicting, it's just the right thing to do. To give.
Man, if he had come today,
we'd be done.
We would have found out. Does he have anything else? But again, I think
what's deceiving in the ordinance is that it, because it says that it doesn't matter if you're here, and it also says you're not allowed to speak.
But you know,
or
I'm
to
not
give
sure
input.
That, I'm not sure that that's really effective under the circumstances. And you know, those of us who have to sit here and judge these things are in a position where we need to have a little bit of it fleshed out.
I understand.
So.
Yes.
I understand the question, and according to the ordinance, Commissioner Mills is correct in the fact that there's not a provision for this, but the option for you to ask questions is not covered in there. Mm-hmm. So therefore, I think that's where we're raising the issue.
And I think by you being able to make a presentation, you know, that also leans me towards the fact that he ought to have an opportunity to say something. Obviously, it's being taped. If he wants to see what the discussion was, he can see it, and then he can put whatever he wants forward. I just think it makes for a fairer, more open process.
And I'm all about that.
Okay, so my duty now would be to contact him, give him the the due date of the 29th. Then the next issue is to set the next meeting with the panel. So are you anticipating that you could meet, like Mr. Homans said, the next week
your,
is Labor Day?
Your reply would be on the 5th, is that, I'm not looking at the calendar, just trying,
so I'm trying
the
to
look
at that. I think the 29th.
I think we would be good to go immediately thereafter, just depending upon our schedules. And what I would suggest is what you did to get this meeting set up, a series of emails right, where we just figure out what will work with everybody that's involved.
As soon as possible when we get the response.
I would say the next week,
unless somebody has a trial conflict, toward the middle to the end of next week. Just so that everybody, if there's something that comes in on the 5th, you have enough time to disseminate. Everybody has enough time to review it. So I would think toward the end of that week would be an appropriate time.
So the end of the week of the
8th. I will be in a conference the 11th and the 12th, but I could do the 10th, just so everybody knows. And I could do the 9th. I have to get my continuing legal education in so I can maintain my license.
Oh, that's unimportant.
All right, and I would also say that we ought to notify Mr. Rorke that at our next meeting, if he wants to attend, you know, he's certainly welcome to attend at that point. I'm not sure that we'll allow him to speak since we're providing this opportunity to respond to us in writing. But I don't want him to think that the writing is exclusive and that he's not to be at the next meeting. When you set this meeting up, did you try to coordinate it so that he could be here?
Well, his options were, actually, no, sir. I'm rethinking your question. No, sir. We have met in all of our dealings when we used to do with the Board of Ethics before it was changed over to an ethics panel. It was always set to when we could get the board together, and now to get the panel members together. And then it, basically, we just, we inform the, both the respondent and the complainant of the time. Neither one of them have input as to when the panel meets.
Well, I think to the extent possible,
okay,
we should make every effort to do it in such a way that he can be here.
Okay.
Just because if the decision is going to run adverse to his petition, he should hear it, and
okay,
he should be here to hear it.
Right.
So
he's entitled to an explanation on the basis of it.
I appreciate that too, because I want to be here, and I mean, and I've had a conflict,
yeah,
with another, and because I've got training just like your training,
mm-hmm,
and they wouldn't make an exception for me either.
Right.
So it's not that it's an exception being made for commissioners that's not being made. No, there's no concession whatsoever.
The American Bar Association comes to Georgia once every blue moon, so I'm going to be there on 112.
Well, I may be on trial that week, yeah, so we'll, I'll know a little bit closer in another week or so. At least talking about something.
I suppose we can adjourn unless there's something else that you have, Kathy.
Well, do we need a motion to?
I think we need a motion to suspend and then resume this hearing on a day to be determined sometime after Monday, September the 8th, as soon thereafter as we can possibly do.
I second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All agreed.
Then I believe the next, unless there's any other discussion, the next item on the agenda would be to adjourn.
Okay, so move.
I doubt that you'll hear opposition.
So we are adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Very good.
You're in Roswell?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're dropping off right along.
Yeah, right off of exit 11, right
when
we parked.
Okay. So Kathy, I signed this. I don't have a notary in my office.
That's quite all right. Mr. Leach and Mr. Hagan, I do not have, and I'll have to get one for you, Mr. Pollack. You know what? Wait before you, that's a good idea. This is Kim's my great backup. I'll make a copy of this before I set it right back in my office.
Okay. I should go ahead and fill it out.
Yeah, you can.
Does that purse come in different models?
No, only one. But I do have the previous one from a couple of years ago that was a Woody station wagon.
There you go. This is so I can
see. Oh, you like that? That's a good job.
No.
From today.
Pretty cool.
It is cool. Thank you. Okay.
And I will be thinking about y'all if y'all meet that way, because I will be at the beach.
Which beach? Which beach are you going to? You may be the most important conflict in the whole group.
Uh-oh.
That should be a delightful time to be down there. The crowds should be less.
They're a lot less.
And I don't know that it's going to be any cooler, but certainly, you know, the crowd control would be a lot easier.
It is a lot less crowded.
Which beach
it's a lot cheaper. Myrtle Beach.
Oh, gosh.
Well, my husband does golf some, so he does like to take them. Okay, well, I think I have information from y'all.
Point me to where I was supposed to park, because I ended up in City Hall.
That's where I parked, too.
Right here behind
right
us.
Huh? Oh, where they're doing all the construction.
Yeah, there's a limited number. A lot on the other side, where you see the white panel there.
That's
public parking.
Or you could have parked in
okay
any of these 1 hours if they were available.
I see.
And then the, right across
there. And where
there
was Mason? You were telling me in Mason.
This is the little bitty street that separates the two parking lots.
This one right here?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
But in the future.
Just come down.
I parked at City Hall.
Take a left.
Yes.
Just beyond the Dairy Queen,
And then that'll be right there when you want.
Okay. Well, it's my first time here. I was lucky to find the building.
There is also a parking deck at the corner of Castleberry and I guess it would be 20 and 9 kind of combined there. 20 coming in from the west side when you come into East 20. There's a parking deck. So if you went out the front of the building, you would actually have to go across the street and then cross the street again. And it's, I call it catty corner for lack of a better word, across from the courthouse. Yes. Yeah. So that's also available parking too.
Are they really ticking you out at City Hall?
No, sir.
They don't care.
Now, as soon as I said that, you'll have a ticket or something.
It says it.
Well, send
it to Miss Fix It.
Haven't you and I had something over the years?
I think so.
Yeah.
I couldn't begin to tell you what or when.
I do go see
I started with
nice to meet
Slip
you,
and helpful. I was one of the founding partners of Drew Echols.
Okay.
And then about 27 years ago, I got tired of helping an insurance company.
I was in the biggest firm in the nation. DOJ.
DOJ. Yeah. So we may have had
it's great to meet you.
Good seeing you again.
Great to meet you again.
All
right. Thank you, Kevin.
Mr. Leach, would it be all right if you and I draw the letter to
and
send
your officer here?
I can even sign it, but I just want to make sure it's like you want it before I send it to him. Okay.
Yeah, I'm happy to look at it.
Okay, I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
I'll take care.
Okay, let me draw these. And then, let's see. Okay, I turn that off. So Cindy will put that on the extra for us, and Nydia will send me a link to that one because she saves me a lot of times. Don't you, Nydia?
I hope so.
Because sometimes on these little tapes, it's hard to tell exactly who's speaking. When it was the Board of Ethics, I kind of knew their voices because I was the same people all the time. I'm Kathy Echols.
I'm Ann Adams. You've been helping me with some questions I had, so that's why I wanted to wait.
Well, good. Now you see the process, too. You can kind of see. This is Kim Reilly.
I think you were there and had helped me where I brought my papers.
So, and Miss Nydia Tisdale, she videos them. So, okay, well, good.
So you'll be seeing me again soon.
Let's see. When is yours?
Next week.
Next week, okay.
I've actually got some amendments and files.
Okay, that may move the day.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yes, so, okay.
But I'm going to try to get that into you tomorrow.
Okay, all right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Nydia. We'll see you later.
You're welcome.
Nice to meet you too.
Bye-bye.